hello, and welcome from the Peterson Automotive Museum. Under normal circumstances, this room would be filled with children learning and playing and just basically experiencing the history of the automobile. Given the special circumstances we find ourselves in, we are coming to you over the internet with a live stream series of discussions, demonstrations, and activities. Today's topic is going to be the history of the automobile. Oh, I'm Jason. I'm the Director of Education here at the museum.
I'm Michaela. I'm the Education Assistant. Today, while we are walking through the history of the car, we have a little activity for you guys to follow along with. Basically, just a timeline lesson. So you can download it off the live stream page, but you can see here it's two pages. We'll have pictures of the cars that we're talking about for you to cut out and just go ahead and glue them onto your timeline. We want you to do it in chronological order, which basically means order year. So as we go through the cars, you'll figure it out and go ahead and follow along. If you want to write years or fun facts next to your timelines, feel free. And if you want to post it to us, just make sure you tag the Peterson at Peterson Museum.
And before we start, I do have to throw out one caveat, particularly for any of our car aficionados in the crowd. We're going to walk through the history of the automobile, but we're using about 40 cars. Out of the thousands and thousands of different models that have been designed, we're obviously going to be leaving a good bit out, probably including the car you think is most relevant for this discussion. We tend to be somewhat biased to cars we either have currently in the museum or which have come through the museum, with a few exceptions. And we also have a little bit of a bias towards the cars that you may not have heard about or seen and all that, basically some of our older vehicles. You will notice as we get close to the modern age, a good bit drops off. But anyways, I think we will get a pretty good story overall about where we've been and where we are heading with the automobile. So to begin, cars obviously have not always been like this Bugatti Devo, although history would be very interesting had it been. But instead, we do start earlier on, and there's probably some debate over exactly when the car started. We'll go full story here and begin in 1769, so 251 years ago. The wheel had been around for millennia, but for most of its history, it was powered by humans or animals. Around the 1700s, you're getting the rise of machines, steam engines, and the like, and someone had the idea that, hey, vehicles could propel themselves if you put an engine on it. So Nicolas Joseph Cugnot, a French military engineer, put a steam engine on a dray, a wagon, used for hauling cannon, and you had what is generally considered the first self-propelled vehicle. Not the most practical. It was a little bit over 24 feet long and weighed over 2.5 tons. Very hard to handle. Also, top speed, just over 2 miles per hour. So probably not as practical as you would expect. And this lack of handling, not the best performance, may also explain why the first vehicle also experienced the first vehicle accident in history. Cugnot, though, established an idea. And for the next decades, through the beginning of the 1800s, you had a series of attempts at putting steam engines or other types of engines on vehicles and carriages and the like and powering them. Up to in 1881, you had the first electric car when Gustave Trouvé put an electric motor on a tricycle. Still not quite to the point, though, of a car like we would think of today. That moment comes in 1886, when Carl Benz receives the patent for what is known as the Benz patent Motorwagen, which is generally considered the first modern car or the first practical car. Now, looking at it, you can see there's a good bit of difference between the cars you see on the road today and Benz's vehicle. Keep in mind, the car does not exist yet. When you say, I'm building a car, there's not anything, a store to go to buy car parts, and anyone's conception of what makes a car. He's relying on what is out there, carriages and the like. So a lot of what you see in the original car, the oversized wheels, lack of a steering wheel, are things that's what they know. And the things we think of in terms of cars haven't been invented yet. Despite the differences, though, there are some things that are still in cars today. That engine in the back is a four-stroke auto-cycle internal combustion engine, just like you would see in any internal combustion car today. It's only one cylinder and gets about 3/4 of a horsepower and powers it up to a top speed of a roaring 10 miles per hour, but the idea is still there, which has gotten better at it. You also, as I mentioned, don't have a steering wheel. No one's invented that yet. You're using a left and right device known as a tiller. But that tiller is attached to a rack and pinion steering system, just like you would see in many cars today. Benz really opened the door and started a process that would be carried forward by inventors everywhere. In Germany, Daimler-Maybach start developing things. In France, you have Levasseur and Peugeot starting the development of their industry. In American case, you'll see the rise of the names that many of us are still familiar with today. Ford, Chrysler, the Dodge brothers, all would begin creating an American auto industry. So in 1903, when Henry Ford gets squeezed out of one of his companies and operations are taken over by Henry Leland, he renames the company Cadillac and introduces the 1903 Cadillac Runabout, which we now refer to as Model A, that begins the Cadillac story and is a good sign of what early American cars look like. Notice the differences. Since then, we're starting to get a more modern look as far as having four wheels, but we still lack a cabin, we lack a roof, we now have a steering wheel, but there's still plenty of things that look different from cars. All kinds of companies are joining the mix at this time. So beyond the ones you still hear about today, like Cadillac, there are companies such as Mercer. Not with us anymore, but at the time in 1913 when this Model 35J came out, Mercer was where it was at if you were wanting speed. Today we may have debates over Ferrari versus Porsche or McLaren or any number of other high-performance car makers. In 1913, the debate would have been Stutz or Mercer. Who did it fastest? And because this Mercer topped out over 60, and if you would have stripped all that extra metal off, getting it up to 80 or 90, that's where it was at for performance. Now, internal combustion taking over and all that, it's not the only game in town early on. You also have cars such as this, a Detroit Electric. Everyone tends to think, because we have recency bias and the like, that electric cars are a brand new thing. But in all reality, electric cars, as you remember, started in 1881, 5 years before that Benz patent motor vehicle can't come out. Electric cars early on were as popular as internal combustion cars, particularly for women. Cars were messy at the time. You had to get out and crank them up. They were dangerous. They were not the easiest thing to use. Electric cars offered push-button simplicity and made it easy. They were designed to accommodate the ladies' fashions of the day, large hats and the like. So in a time where gender roles were fairly well-defined, electric cars provided an option, and that's how they were marketed. Once you get to the point, though, of the electric starter being introduced and the like, internal combustion is going to take over, including one particular internal combustion-powered car that redefined history.
So that brings us to the Ford Model T. So this is going to be the car that we think of that's going to change history here in America. Before this, cars were expensive to build. Like Jason said, it took many parts. You have to find people to build the parts. The Model T is going to change that. So Ford starts building the Model T in 1908. He's going to build it through to 1927, so that's a period of 19 years. And in that time, he built 15 million of them. So this is going to completely change the field. Everyone will be able to have a car and be driving. And the way he does this is by adopting that moving assembly line. So basically, you start with nothing. Each person has a job. The car moves on the line in front of them, and everyone adds their job. And at the end, you have a finished product. With this process, Ford could build a car in 90 minutes. So very quickly, and that makes it very easy to just get them out on the road. They were also incredibly affordable, maybe $250 towards the end of their life, $800 to start, which is not a lot of money today, but back then would have been quite a chunk of change. But nowhere near your Mercer, which is $3,500 at any given point. So Ford is going to make this process look so easy that you will actually see companies try to replicate it. This is a 1911 Babcock. Anyone familiar with that name? Probably not anymore. They started out building carriages. Ford made it look so easy to build cars, they thought they could do it too. Didn't work out for them. They are going to go through a few cycles of changes and eventually just disappear. What you will see is the rise of GM. So this is a 1922 Chevy 490 Coupe, similar to the year of our 1918 Ford Model T. Did you see a difference in the styling? Go back a few so you can see. If you had a choice, you would probably choose the Chevy, right? Looks a little bit nicer, similar price point, but it's going to have an electric starter, which is also going to be a huge selling point. And basically what you see is GM is going to take over styling. With Ford's, every single car was the exact same. He even had a marketing campaign, you can get my car in any color as long as it's black. So you had very limited choices. GM is going to capitalize on this and offer as many choices as they possibly could, which means GM sales are going to skyrocket. Eventually, that is going to force Ford to change, and it brings us to the Ford Model A in 1931. Basically, Ford doesn't want to revolutionize. He doesn't want to change. And it's actually his son who convinces him, in order to keep up and to continue selling cars, they actually do have to make a change. And so he introduces the Ford Model A. It only adds about 20 horsepower to the engine to make it a little bit faster, but he offers four color choices, right? So that's going to be a huge step up for Ford from black. And that is going to create an increase in market demand.
So while Ford and their competitors are revolutionaries in the industry and really getting cars in the hands of the masses, instead of early on where cars were largely bespoke creations targeting the rich, the rise of mass production in the industry and all that is going to make it, instead of dozens of cars being produced, millions of cars being produced, and more people have them. The other thing that starts happening, particularly by the time you reach the 20s, is you're getting far greater diversity. As I'm building millions of cars, I can begin targeting specific areas, specific niches, specific types of cars. So you get the rise of custom-built race cars. Instead of taking the car that you had built for the road and, oh, I can race it too, you're starting to get people like Gary Miller right here in Los Angeles who are building cars custom-built for racing. You are also seeing the creation of the luxury brand. All cars early on, keep in mind, right, are, until you get to the Model T, they're hand-built. Model T introduces mass production where every car begins looking the same, standardization. But if you had the means, there were still a class of companies out there known as coach builders. You would go to the car company to buy your chassis and the engine, but you could go and get a custom body created for your car by a separate company, a coach builder, so that it makes it somewhat your own. This was luxury. But there were also the luxury marks, such as Rolls-Royce, who built this car right here that was eventually owned by a famous celebrity that you may not be familiar with, but your parents and grandparents would be Fred Astaire. And the Rolls-Royce brought with it size, power. That's a whole lot of hood housing a very powerful engine, much more than that 0.75 horsepower in the engine that we saw in Ben's patent motorbike. This was luxury. American had their luxury makes too. This was a Duesenberg. At the time, premier. Came at a cost. All that power, all that class came at a cost. Okay? You would pay upwards of $9,000 or $10,000 for the chassis and the engine on a Duesenberg and still have to go out and find a body for it. Whereas, as Michaela told you, you could go buy a Model T body and all for $500 or so. So the idea though is the car industry is diversified. We're creating all kinds of different levels, all kinds of different price points and all that for the automobile. Along comes the Great Depression. 1929, you have a stock market crash. A lot of companies are not going to survive, but there is still going to be innovation going on, particularly in styling. This right here started life as a 1925 Rolls-Royce. It would have looked nearly identical to that one, a 27 Rolls-Royce van. This one, though, as I mentioned, is a coach-building story. In 1934, this car, in its original form, found itself in Belgium, where a Belgian coach-builder known as Jan Geer decided to rebody it. They traditionally made buses, which may explain why their envisioning of the Rolls-Royce is bus size. It's also a very unique style compared to the Rolls as we see. A slanted radiator, round doors, and that overall shape you see that's starting to evolve by the 30s. If I look at my earlier luxury marks, very boxy, lots of right angles. But by the time you reach the 30s, there's a couple things coming together to change the overall perception of style. This is when the Art Deco movement is taking hold. It's also the era where we're starting to focus on aerodynamics. We want sleeker lines, greater curves, things like tail fins and all that that may play with the whim just right. So you get what is one of the iconic Peterson Museum cars, and once things settle down, you can come and visit it here. And also, you can visit it, you can see it on the live stream we will begin today later on this afternoon. Rolls-Royce Roundel Rolls-Royces aren't all of that story. You get such cars such as this Alfa Romeo 8C that a couple years ago won a famous car show known as Pebble Beach, and cars such as the Bugatti Atalanta. Okay? Bugatti, early on, great performance, adds in style, and by the time you reach the 30s, you're creating some of the most premier cars of history in that they're both powerful but also beautiful. So we really have set ourselves up for great innovation in cars. Unfortunately, at the end of the 30s, you have world dynamics take over, and the car industry basically goes on hold for a few years. In 1940, American producers were producing cars in the millions. By around 1942, you would measure their production in the hundreds. Things kind of die off until the war ends. We come out of it with new technologies and new demands that are really going to revolutionize the car world. You get such things as this, the very first Ferrari. It's not Enzo Ferrari's first car. He had some other companies along the way. But it's the first car with a Ferrari badging, just like the Ferraris you would see on the road today. The story here is basically all of that pent-up demand that you have coming out of the war is driving people's interest in having a new car. And for a lot of returning GIs, they want sports cars like they had seen in Europe while they were there. The big three producers in America were still retooling from after building tanks and trucks during the war. So several dynamics were going to come into play, one of which is the rise of the European import. The Ferrari we know forms in 1947. Porsche really begins to start sending cars to America in 48. So you get an influx of European sports cars to satisfy that demand that GIs have for starting down the road.
This gap after World War II is also going to lead to a rise of independence. So what you'll start to see besides European imports is smaller companies coming out and trying something new. So you get examples like the 1947 Cis Italia 202 Coupe coming out of Italy. This small company started licensing cheap Fiat parts in order to make their cars more affordable. But you get the beauty of coach building from a company called Pininfarina, who is also going to body Ferrari. So you get basically a switch in our car. Instead of thinking of it as two separate parts that you have to bring together, you're going to start looking at it as a whole piece. And so you get very clean, sweeping lines, one body instead of adding each individual part on. So this is going to change the way that we style our cars. You also start focusing on things like safety. So this may not have been a concern early on. Our cars aren't driving as fast, so you don't need things like seat belts. Once we start speeding up, safety is going to become much more of a concern. And so that brings us to our Tucker from 1948. Preston Tucker is going to come out with this design, and his whole focus is safety. So everything about the car is designed to make it safer to drive. He's the first one to think of adding seat belts, right? And that was such a revolutionary idea, you won't actually see it in every car until the 70s or 80s, right? So this is going to be a huge shift. You also see things like a rear engine, padded dashboard, your windshield might pop out if you get into an accident, and a Cyclops headlight right here in the middle. That's not something we see every day. That's actually connected to the steering. So as you take a corner, your light leads the way, and it makes it safer to drive at night. You may also get mistakes, like the Davis sedan. So this car here from 1948 was Gary Davis's idea of what the automobile of the future might be like. So it was named after the couch. It's one bench seat straight across, three wheels. His idea was that a family of four could sit in this car and have a nice road trip. Not really a great idea. Very few people wanted to sit their entire family inside this car. So he goes into production, he ends up building 16 cars, and then it fails miserably, and he may or may not have ended up in jail. But, fun fact about the Davis sedan, when Gary Davis gets out of jail, he's the original designer of bumper cars, which you may see here from this lovely bumper. It fits, right? So that leads us to...
There's other things going on, right? We tend to have a little bit of a focus on American and European mix, but all of this post-war change and explosion industry is going on everywhere, including in Japan. Japan's all facing different sets of circumstances than American producers, and some overlap with European producers, but really the Japan story is its own thing. You're recovering from war. You're trying to rebuild your industries. Japan views the automotive industry as one easy way to do that. But you're starting from a baser point. You have to build the industries. You're not ready for as much wide-scale production until you get all that launched. Japan also faces unique circumstances that may not be faced in America. Resource limitations alike that provided an impetus for fuel efficiency and the like that Americans are not going to face for decades off. So instead of the giant Duesenbergs and all that that we've been looking at for the American story, in Japan, some of our most notable cars are things like this 1960 Mazda 360, which a company that still exists, and the fuel efficiency and sleek compactness are ideas to carry on. So some of these are lasting successes. Others maybe not so. This is a 1955 Fuji cabin that lasted 1955. So sometimes the ideas are great and last for decades, other times they don't. But not to mischaracterize the story, not everything Japan was producing was small and fuel efficient. They also have desire for style and performance. So you also got cars such as this 1967 Toyota 2000 GT.
So while you get performance from some of the major car companies, not everyone's going to be able to afford that. And so what you actually see, especially after the war, is a rise in customs and hot rods. And these are people basically taking production cars that they have at home, specifically cars they may have had before the war, and retooling them at home to make them faster and then taking them out and racing them. This is going to be particularly popular right here in Southern California and is a major part of our history and our history here at the museum. You have here a 1947 McGee Roadster, and we say 1947 because it's actually a 1932 Ford Roadster, but he started finished customizing it in 1947. So basically, you take a 1932 Ford, and you're going to customize it. You can change anything to this body. It's going to look different than what it started as, and make it more aerodynamic, make it faster, make it easier to drive. So you get 32 Fords getting manufactured. You're also going to start to see cars like this. So basically, post-World War II, you have a lot of veterans coming home from the war. They have all these new mechanic skills. What you also have is a huge leftover and surplus of military supplies. L.A. was a major source of manufacturing for the war. When the war ends, all of that is just going to stay right here in L.A. And so you get these people who are these veterans who are retooling cars, and they start to notice the aerodynamic shape of the fuel tanks from our World War II aircraft, right? This basically would fly underneath the plane as they were crossing the ocean. As soon as they used up the fuel tank drops off, and it falls into the ocean. This is incredibly aerodynamic because it has to fly, right? Well, that makes an incredible race car. So someone notices the fuel tank, realizes they can fit an engine in it, buys one for $5 from military surplus, and outfits it and creates one of the fastest hot rods we're going to see on the dry lake beds here in the 40s. What that also is going to do is lead to a rise in customs. Not everybody's interested in speed, right? So you're going to take your car and you're going to make it fit your style. So you get things like our 1951 Hirohata Mercury, which basically they're recustomizing the Mercury body, making it look different than it was. Not everyone is going to like this style, and so that is going to lead to a diversification, and it's going to fit across cultural barriers as well. So you start to see the rise of lowrider culture. So this is Gypsy Rose, probably one of the most famous lowriders in lowrider history. And basically, these are going to be the opposite of hot rods. Instead of fast and loud, they're going to be low and slow, and you take all the time to pay attention to the detailing put into the car. And it seems like we might have an audience question. So, hit us. So
they are faster than what the base car would have been. So a lot of these early on are 32 Fords, the Deuce, and similar cars and all that, but you're making a hot rod gain, probably you could add 100 or so horsepower. And so early hot rods, you're going to be getting in that low 100s, mid 100s range and all that most likely. Whereas today, if you go get yourself a Bugatti Chiron, you can go to 250 or so. So not quite to the same horsepower. Right nowadays, we speak about cars getting 1,000 or 1,500 horsepower in the hypercar range. Whereas back then, leading out into a couple hundred and all that would have been a big leap. Keep in mind, a Duesenberg Model SSJ in the early 30s could get upwards of 400 horsepower. So it all comes down to a lesson we will learn to draw on is a source of horsepower. That era of great big engines, it's all displacement. You can pump out a lot of power by having an engine that's half the size of this desk. Later on, as we get concerned about weight and we get better materials and everything else, engines can downsize, and things like RPM can be ways of boosting speed. So generally speaking, most of these hot rods would be blown off the road by a modern high-performance car, but for the day, it would have been blowing off the road the original cars they were based on. So moving on, we set up this idea coming out of the war that you had a variety of trends, largely market responses. You had new companies forming to export that were exporting cars in the U.S. You had independent producers, and you had people on their own driveways building, right, taking an old car and making it their own. The big car companies, though, have not disappeared, and they are certainly going to keep innovating and keep adapting to what market demands are. It's particularly true once you hit the 50s. By the 50s, the car has become an integral part in our lives. No longer is it an accessory to kind of help us out on things and strictly utilitarian. By the time you get to the 50s, the car is truly becoming enmeshed in American lives and culture. This is aided by the fact that it's also the 50s that the interstate system comes about. Whereas previously you had had roads and parkways and the like, it's really in the 50s that you start seeing all of these things become connected and upgraded and maintained to the point where instead of getting in my car to drive across town or up the road to a store, I can start thinking about driving between towns, between states, across the country. If I'm in my car that long on a long road trip, I don't want to be in that 1903 Cadillac with no roof, no doors, and cramped with my family. I want something that's comfortable, that's stylish, perhaps a Chevy Bel Air. Cool convertible, wind in my hair, sun on my face, power under the hood, and padding on my seats. That's what I want to be in if I'm in the car for 8 hours with my family. So you get this add-on of the car becoming icons of style. Notice in the back, those tail fins. You see them even more on this Plymouth Fury. Tail fins at the time, they may have said, well, it adds some aerodynamic characteristics. Those are there for no other reason because they look cool. I believe we have another question.
What is the fastest car in the museum?
Ooh, currently in the museum. So the Bugattis I mentioned going 250 and the like, I don't think we have any currently. So you will see some if you sign up for our live stream vault tours later. We have a couple modern McLarens. We have several other supercars. We have three generations of Ford GT in the museum. So I can't give you an exactitude. We have a few cars that will go over 200, but not quite the fastest cars on the road today. Another question. Oh, the green monster that is not green. So it is painted red and white, and let's just say the world of racing has many classes and many personalities, and there's all kinds of things that are done to cars over time. So we've been through various phases of adding different types of engines and the like. I'm of a certain age that I grew up occasionally going to the drag races, and it was the late 70s when there was the era of the rocket dragster. This was a byproduct of a lot of hydrogen, liquid hydrogen peroxide fluid, no longer being held by the military and being released onto the market. And one way we found to burn through that is to put it in a car to make it go fast. So basically I can tell you is that you probably won't see many like it, and I bet you most of them will actually call it a color that the car actually is. I can't tell you why the green monster is not green, but regardless, there's all kinds of cars out there, and the museum has hundreds of those type of stories to tell. So join us later for our live stream, and once everything settles down, please be sure to visit us. Back to our story of our fancy, stylish cars. Not everyone is just wanting to get around with their family. Some people still want to go fast and do other things. Maybe, hey, go camping. wagon. Chevy Nomad is actually in the Bel Air family, but here you've gone for less convertible, sun in your face, more room for cargo and hauling stuff around. But as we mentioned, there's always been a desire for performance. Cars are going to follow that. This year, the 1956 Jaguar XKSS. It's actually a race car turned into a street car, the D-type racer that had some success. Jaguar, after some situations that they're backing away from actual racing somewhat, they have a surplus of a few cars that they want to turn into road-going sports cars, and you get the XKSS, but by the end of the day, only 16 are made. You also have the big three American producers start finally responding to that pent-up demand for sports cars. In 1953, the Corvette launches. This is actually a 61, but the 53 will look fairly similar. These are all first-generation Corvettes. This is followed on in 55 with the original Ford Thunderbird, which starts life as a two-seat sports car. It's later in the 50s that goes to the four-seat model most of us know. You also get that mix of Europe and America, a whole lot of American horsepower put in a English-designed body, the Shelby Cobra. European companies, though, are still in the mix. Here is one of your most iconic sports cars of history. This is a Ferrari 250 GTO. Not many made, only a few dozen made, but these are one of the greatest collector's items of today. All that sports car building, some for racing, some for just going fast in a two-seat sports car, spills over into greater demands for performance. By the 60s, you're hitting the muscle car era, where you're wanting to put those big American engines, the muscle, in a little bit larger car, but now I'm not maybe worried about winning European endurance racing, but if I can beat my neighbor on the quarter mile up the street, it's good to go. Sports car styling will continue to evolve. Those cars I was just looking at, right? These sports cars, lots of smooth lines. In 1970, the Lancia Stratos comes out and kind of sets the design phase that's going to follow. Wedges. Instead of everything being smooth curves, I'm now, because I'm playing with the air in certain ways and all that, I'm getting a more wedge look that most famously will be demonstrated in the Lamborghini Countach that comes out later on.
All right. Well, not everything is always about speed, so we do want to focus on our lifestyle vehicles as well. If you're not looking to race your car, perhaps you're looking for something to take to the beach, to go surfing, or take camping with your family, or to just drive across America, which brings us to iconic vehicles. First of all, we have to mention the Volkswagen Beetle, right, which actually is going to eventually surpass the Model T in amount of cars made. So its follow-up, the Transporter van, is incredibly iconic, especially to us here in Southern California, because you do start to get those cars that play up a lifestyle. Surf culture, right? This is the car that you take to the beach. Going along with that, the Fiat Chalet. So this is a 1970 Fiat Chalet, which is your updated Jolly. The Jolly was the car that was small enough, you could park it on your yacht, go island hopping, drive it on the beach, right? So you get wicker seating, so the sand just falls right through and you're not impacting your car at all. I want one, even though I don't go to the beach that often. And eventually that is going to lead us to other concerns besides just lifestyle, right? In the 1970s, we are going to face an oil crisis, and basically people want fuel-efficient cars. No longer are we looking for these incredibly powerful American engines. We are going to turn and look to Japan. So this is the Honda N600 from 1968. Honda started out as a motorcycle manufacturer. This is their first car, attempted a four-wheeler, and although the N600 wasn't as successful, it's follow-up, the Honda Civic, is still on the road today. So you're going to see a shift in our buying patterns, and we are going to start looking for more fuel-efficient, smaller options.
So the basic idea that we've come to now is that from its infancy, where everyone was just trying to get something to move, right? How do you get an engine on wheels? You get greater and greater diversification in terms of our goals. Do I want speed? Do I want comfort? Do I want style? Do I want fuel efficiency? All these things are going to lead to cars taking on many, many, many forms. And that's the trend that's going to continue past the 70s. You get to the point where even a company that defined itself by the sports car, Porsche, right? The 911, probably one of the most iconic cars out there. By the 80s, they're already experimenting with sedans and station wagons and family cars that by today are their most popular sellers. Even the sports car companies are trying to hit all of these demands. And so the end story, you can look out on the road today. There's different sizes, there's different styles, there's different performance levels. There's all kinds of different things for people to find the car that they want. Some people may want something comfortable. Some people may want something that just looks cool. Some people may want something that they can race down the road faster than anyone else. And that's what we have in the overall history of the car. Thank you for joining us. This afternoon, we will be having a hands-on activity where we make our own license plates. And then join us again tomorrow at 10, where we're actually going to have story time with Go Dog Go. Goodbye.
Bye.